So it's a pleasure serving the community and giving something back. So I'm very devoted to that. So it's just happened, and I'm very happy that I got appointed. And I'll make sure to do my job at a very high level. So looking forward to working with you all.
Well, congratulations and welcome.
That's great.
And then first on the agenda is the budget process timeline. I looked it over, and I mean, I guess it's clear that we're going to share all the meetings with the selectmen and the school committee, and hopefully have quorums at all of them.
Yeah, that's the hope.
And be ready to participate in the discussions as well.
Didn't we last year have these meetings happening in February? Didn't they happen in March?
Yeah, we accelerated everything because of the expected override.
Okay.
And so we want to get the final budget out. So really, the budget ends up being approved. Is it the March 7th meeting that we would actually approve the budget, or the 15th?
No, 15th of February.
Okay, yeah.
Hopefully.
Yeah.
There was a lot of back and forth discussion on the schedule last meeting. This reflects where we landed.
Yeah.
Okay.
We saw interpretation of
Sometimes it seems confusing.
Because we are really trying to understand what time frame the selectmen needed to come up with an override number, assuming they do that, and yet give any group time to prepare. And that we realized that whole cycle can go independent of us voting the budget.
So override, the timing of that is, the voting of that would be if, is that an if or is that a when?
If, April 3rd is the next local election, that's when it would be if it happens.
Okay.
But we're trying to get the selectmen comfortable to be able to understand what the shortfall would be at the end of January, right? Isn't that what we, you back with?
I couldn't remember whether they were comfortable to vote on January 24th or not from the meeting I watched. I know you discussed it, and I haven't asked them since.
I thought it was January 19th or something.
I did too. Yeah.
Well, that's just a technicality of when the school committee gives me a budget. The meeting is the 24th of all the boards.
But I thought that they said that they had no problem with that, but maybe I'm mistaken.
I seem to.
So their meeting is the same night as the financial forum?
Well, their meeting is part of the financial forum. Also, I should have asked him yesterday, but a couple weeks ago, John Doherty said he thought he was going to add another school committee meeting sometime in this January timeframe, just so you know. I don't know if he has, and I'm not sure what the date is. It was before the 18th.
So it's a much bigger schedule than we've had in the past. And so hopefully we'll get quorums at all of the meetings, and probably won't get 100% attendance, but hopefully we will certainly get quorum.
Is it the 16th, or will it be the 15th? I see it's
It's the Tuesday, whichever that is.
Okay, so that's
because I'm pretty sure that's Martin Luther King.
Got it.
Monday.
Okay.
I'm not sure what the dates are. 8/15, I think, is a Monday.
Okay, that makes sense.
And my recollection was your FinCom meetings in February with the town and schools are shorter because there's more meetings in December and January, and then hopefully FinCom would attend. So what you see in December from town department heads, you won't see repeated. It's more meant for, I guess, question and answer update in February as opposed to presentation. See how that goes.
I was wondering whether we would then need four meetings in February.
I don't know, really.
I think they were thinking
possibly not
informational sessions more than anything for public comment.
Yeah, it's possible you'll just need schools one night, town one night, and then you're set. I mean, there are other things, capital and benefits and all that, but it's not that hard. I think the discussion was, let's just plan on four and see what happens. And I'm pretty sure the week of the 14th and 15th is school vacation, which is why the schools wanted to, or had to go earlier. But just so you're aware, you know, that may not be a full FinCom.
Is that February vacation?
I think so.
It seems early if the 14th is a Wednesday. Does that mean the 12th would be, isn't it the third Monday?
No, I'll check, but I remember having a chat with John.
I think it's the 19th.
Unless you ended up moving it up a week from what John and I had talked about, which is always possible. I was impressed you picked Valentine's Day for a meeting. That, maybe that's the extra day that goes.
Maybe.
I definitely don't have a school calendar, so I can't tell you. You have plenty of time to change.
Yeah, I think the 19th is school vacation week, though. Does anybody have any questions on the schedule besides what we've already had? And so the meeting on March 7th would be to just vote on the remaining warrant articles, okay?
October 4th, because we have to go to print.
How many do you think there'll be?
I really don't know. I have an outline of articles. There's definitely a current year budget amendment because we have, or will have some extra new growth. Well, I shouldn't say extra, I don't know that, but I'm hoping. And I know there's some other surplus numbers. I don't know where we need to spend them yet, so that'll, we might have to reduce the use of free cash. Otherwise, I can't think offhand of any financial articles. Do you know any of any, Sharon?
Mm-mm. I'm hoping for none, just because I don't know how soon we get to advise. So.
Yeah, well, what the hell, yes, yes. The library trustees wanted to amend a revolving fund. I'm not sure if we do that in November or April. And that would probably require some FinCom opinion. It's just to change the list of the purpose.
It's not financial in terms of any money.
No, it doesn't spend money. I don't think there's anything else. I guess not.
So on the 14th, when it says other, so I was just checking last year. So last year we had two town meeting, two
town, one school.
One school.
And
is the other supposed to be as a backup in case we need another town, or what is it?
It's kind of like for the town one. For the schools, it's the same as you always do. For the town one, I know you can do all the departments. I don't know if we'll have time, depending on how many questions they have, to do all the debt, the capital, you know, health insurance, so on and so forth. And that could be other. That's kind of what
so
I was thinking.
So you think actually we can do town in one night?
Yeah. If you don't need, you know, lengthy presentations by department heads, absolutely.
Yeah, so is the framework to not have the...
That's what would happen in the December meetings. That's why we'd ask
okay.
as many of you to come as possible. And the good thing is RCTV puts these up on YouTube a couple days after they happen,
yeah.
So pretty easy to watch.
You're going to have enough information by December?
We're
going to
try.
I promised the selectmen I'd give them a budget December 8th, so we'll see.
So, no other questions or issues with the calendar that we've got here? All right. And then next item is the disposal of surplus property.
We want to skip that till next month because we need to talk to procurement a little bit more.
Yeah.
That's an old email in there from Greg Burns, 2 years ago.
Is that an actual up-to-date, something that you wanted to secure surplus?
There is a general bylaw and there are policies and I want to make sure they all line up, so she was gonna look into that. Because there's at least a slight possibility we might want a town meeting warrant article to make a change to go along with state law.
You wanna take the benchmark?
Yeah, this is kind of an interesting area. I hope FinCom will read some of the stuff we're working on, but I'm gonna ask you to amend your October 13th policy and add Concord and Lexington. You can see on your packet on page 5. The last pay, non-union pay and classification vendor we hired added those communities based on whatever his criteria were. So he actually had 25 communities, although you'll see a footnote at the bottom, not all of them had fully answered some of the surveys. And I, just for convenience, I reproduced some stuff from last summer just to show you, indeed, we've been using these 25 for a couple of years now since then. Just never asked you to update the policy. So there's the list of the 25 on the left. And that's an example summary on the right on page 7 of 25.
So you're saying this list of peer communities came from that study that...
The first 23 came from the first consultant, Stone Consulting.
Yeah.
And then the second consultant started with that list and added two more. They each ran different types of math. I honestly think the first one did a lot more in-depth math because they told me about it. The second one would never tell me, but he said, statistically, you've got to add these two in. So I wasn't sure I liked it at first, and I did some math, and I took one or two out. It doesn't make any difference. When you get 23 or 25 towns, the impact was minimal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I just don't want to keep moving the target, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I think we're set.
Because it starts to lose its...
You know, I'll show you in the next few pages, we've done so much work since then on all 25 that I think that 25 is good. And for anyone who's in front of you or town meeting, sometimes it's 26, sometimes it's 24. There will be reasons why there's more or less, which I'll actually start showing you on the next page.
Mm-hmm.
But the 25 is a really good core. If you really wanted to start throwing towns out, I could definitely help you do that. There's some on the list at both ends economically that you could shed and say, you know, too high, too low. But we've looked at this so many different ways. As a group, it acts well. There's always a reason to throw someone out, but then you find out, you know, gee, we would have thrown them out, but they're just like us in this one thing. And the average for the 25 is so close to Reading in so many ways.
Because I look at Concord and Lexington, although you said we've already been comparing, I go, whoa, you know, I... necessarily consider them peer communities.
Surprised.
But statistically they are.
Realtors say they are.
Yeah.
Believe it or not.
Huh.
I was a little surprised at that.
Yeah.
If you look at pages 8 and 9, I don't know how many of you are following our economic development peer community project. There's been 3 different meetings in front of the selectmen so far. There'll be an October 4th economic development summit that I would certainly urge any FinCom member to attend. This actually used 26 communities, so we added Melrose on purpose because they're a lot like us in so many ways, and they're obviously a neighbor.
Yes.
Besides, they're very nice. So there's a map of sort of what the 26 communities look like. And we visited a number of them, done a lot of data analysis, and I just wanted to give you an example on page 9. We're working on a draft report. We have mountains of data. This is an example, and I found this type of work to be really interesting. If you look at 2010, the column that says average monthly employment, and that means to be divided by population age 20 to 64. So if you think of what that says, I'll say that that's telling you whether you import or export labor, because the labor pool is generally age 20 to 64. If you have more than 100%, that means you're importing daytime labor. If you have less than 100%, you're exporting daytime labor. So no surprise, Burlington right on the top with all the retail and other, you know, commercial businesses there. And you can see Reading is fairly close to the bottom. We export workers, and there's 2 years there, 2010, 2015. We did a lot of work on those 2 years on purpose. And the other thing which I decided not to put in the packet because it's too depressing is the average salary of workers in Reading of the 26 communities is the lowest, which is really surprising to me.
So average salary
of the employee in Reading.
Not the exporters.
No. Not the people who live in Reading.
Yes.
The jobs in Reading.
Jobs in Reading are the lowest paid jobs of any 26 communities. I mean, here we are studying economic development. That was interesting.
Right.
Because you're looking at
retail.
Home Depot.
Grocery stores. Yeah, exactly.
It's not office complexes.
Right. Not a lot of technology. Some medical, some lawyer or office, but not a lot. So we've used, you know, again, quite a lot of data to try to study this, and you know, if you haven't seen any of the selectmen's meetings, there's an economic development page on our website you could look for. It's got a lot of stuff, and the October 4th meeting will be interesting. The whole idea of, I guess broadly, our economic development effort is to try to make sure everyone is comfortable that we've done everything we can to dig up revenue in whatever shape it takes. Give you an order of magnitude. If we could develop another Walker's Brook, more or less, double what's down there, we'd add maybe $2 million of revenue. So not bad, but not solving problems. Still not bad.
Yeah.
And that's the objective, generally speaking. So you look around town, there's not a lot of opportunities other than to add at the margin. And you'll also hear on October 4th an update. There's a lot going on. Since we passed new zoning in April, the downtown area is red hot. There's three different developers looking at buildings to buy them and knock them down and put a multi-story, probably residential at the top and commercial on the bottom. So there's two that I can think of that are definitely in progress, and a third that's a maybe. So, you know, all of these will add some amount of tax revenue. They'll add some amount of costs, probably less cost than revenues. And we're not talking order of magnitude. Oh, we're all set. It's just we're doing everything we can.
So yeah. When Curie was here before they went to Burlington, how was that? How would you describe?
Well, you know, it sort of didn't matter because the building is still assessed the same way. Okay. If it stays vacant for 3 or 4 years, then it's assessed lower. But, you know, the actual tenants sort of don't matter. It's the assessed value unless the tenant drives the value of the building.
Right, I meant more.
Oh, for employees. They weren't big enough to have a big impact, but I'm sure they had an impact.
Okay.
And they would have left after 2015 numbers. Well, it would have had started. Some of them are still here. So.
Has it been any progress in terms of who's taking that over? That building, is it still empty?
Reading Co-op is down there. And the last time I was there, someone was on the rest of their floor, so that one's filled. I'm not sure. I'd say it's at least partly filled, not more.
And the average salary, so that's an interesting number to look at and so on, but in terms of economic development, we're not getting any revenue based on that, right? It's still the assessed value of a commercial building, right?
But if you were going to open a business and you needed customers, all the customers are leaving town during the day.
Oh, okay, because the assumption is those are your customers that are working here, not living here. I got you.
Yeah, okay. I mean, it's not a simple thing, but that's one of the things I'd think about.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas, I can't remember, but let me see if I can remember by looking. Bedford had a very high average wage of job in town, a lot of high-tech, biotech.
Mm-hmm.
Higher than Burlington, certainly. And, you know, and I'm not necessarily saying one or the other is your objective, but it was interesting to see. And again, not something I would have guessed if you'd asked me. I'd have said, oh, we're probably in the bottom third.
Mm-hmm.
I wouldn't have said dead last, so.
That sort of ties to the percentage of residential versus commercial too, then.
To a degree, yeah.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, if we had one really well-paying commercial, it would move the needle more. We just don't have them.
Are we doing anything actively or as part of the economic development? Is that, are there any plans to do anything actively for that space?
Yeah, longer term, but yeah.
As far as benchmarking, though, so is it fair to say that we will expect to see those names of communities for all sort of benchmarking that we're going to see, whether it's from school, town?
Yeah, by and large, I looked at schools' work, and by and large, they've been following this pattern for a while, including the new communities. Occasionally, they stray off when they want to do a different thing, like Middlesex League or whatever the things are. But if you look at their budget presentation for the last 2 years, this is the group they've used.
Yeah,
so
no, I remember some of the names. I'm just thinking from
the
consistency.
Same, the exact same.
Exact same. Yep.
Okay.
Well, not Melrose, but
okay.
Otherwise, yeah. I think it's really helpful to have common language, I guess I'd say.
Right, because I thought part of what, when we voted that, was to request that comparisons both on school and municipal.
Yeah, and John has agreed with that. And, you know, one of the things that your policy allowed, which I thought was very good, is, you know, if you want to change it, that's fine. Just let us know good reason.
Mm-hmm.
So we were to really start giving you fire EMS data, we would probably not want to use, we'd show you this list and let you compare, and then we'd show you a second list and says, here's a much better list, because these communities have advanced life support like we do. All the others don't, so really you can't compare. Because, you know, we're bringing in $700,000-$800,000 of revenue from ambulances and the other guys aren't. So you want to start looking at things. So there's always an argument to be made why you have to go another step. Once in a while.
Maybe it would be helpful if we could know, you know, you could outline what were the filters, like what the statistic data that you're saying that was used to for that.
Okay, I can go look at the report. It was like 9 or 10 socioeconomic, demographic, and financial data. I'm sure we could sit here and probably figure it out, but I just don't remember off the top of my head.
Because knowing what the band of it is, you know, how broad, we may want to say maybe it shouldn't be that broad, you know, because,
yeah,
as you know, depending on your peer group, you know, things can change drastically.
Well, what do you think is one or two most important variables to determine peers?
So, on the revenue side, tax.
On any side.
Well,
any,
no, on
any,
both
any
sides, so you have to look on both sides, right? So, we want to look at on the revenue side, taxes, obviously, that's the biggest.
Tax rate?
Yeah.
Yeah,
and then number of the population, right? So what's the range? I don't know what the right range is. That's why I would like to see it so that we can kind of rationalize around there. What's that?
Property values.
Yeah, property values. On the expense side, salaries, as you said.
That I know was not used.
That was not used.
Salaries for, were you thinking for residents or employees?
So that's
maybe
a good point. Household income may have been used.
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah. Sorry, my bad. Income then.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so far you've named things that I know are in there.
Okay. So that's the thing. Maybe
I think equalized value, I think that's what it's called for assessed value.
Yeah, that's what
it's used. Try to think of what else.
It would be helpful just to maybe to see.
Form of government, so towns but not cities.
Yes, definitely.
There was a band on population. Don't remember exactly. North Reading was definitely, or I'm sorry, Linfield was definitely at the low end. And
we look at like education levels of the residents.
I don't think so. No. Yeah, I'd have to look at the rest. You hit the main ones that I would have remembered.
On the expense side, what can we think about the expense side?
I don't think they looked at any of that because they wanted to determine like communities, not what they chose to do.
Yeah. Yeah, that makes sense.
So they didn't study, for instance, how many school kids.
Mm-hmm.
That's something that happened later. You know, there are or there aren't. Lots of
right,
they did not study what's the CIP versus residential ratio, and believe me, so that's all over the map.
Yeah.
So, again, as I say, you can almost pick out any number of single data points and say, well, these three don't belong at each end, but when you mush them all together, they sort of make sense. And again, the averages are very tight to Reading, and I have all that. I can show you stuff.
Governance structure, right? That's one of the...
Yeah, but we excluded the cities. And I should also just be clear with you that all that data was not shared with me. It was the consultant's work, and they said, just like they did salary surveys from all these communities, we never saw that. We just saw the composite. That was part of the reason they could do it, is it was anonymous. So we relied on the consultant and took their work as opposed to participated with them, just so you know. But I can find what they sent me.
My point was, depending on how broad the band is, you may want to narrow it down, and I don't know that. I don't know. For example, I'm just applying, when I do benchmarking for our company, we look at top line, we look at bottom line from profitability, and then we look at growth, right?
Yeah.
Year over year growth. And then, so if I compare our company to, you know, being $2 billion, $3 billion to a Microsoft, that doesn't make sense. So
yeah.
So that's why I'm saying I don't know the band, and I want to know what band was used here. And
okay.
I don't know about what you guys feel. These names sound right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
but
and look at page 8 at the map. They talked a lot about geography because one of the purposes of why we hired them, again, was a competitive wage survey. How competitive is Reading? And so one of the questions we debated was, well, why should Reading have to compete against, like, Scituate or, you know, somewhere far away? Is anyone really going to decide between Reading and Scituate and just commute? So they weighted, as you can see, they weighted our geography, and that's why you see these guys tight. But they didn't totally exclude communities that were, you know, what you would say is not a commuting distance. I forget, that's Marshfield, I think, on the far.
Marshfield,
yeah.
I was
trying to figure that out.
And then Mansfield, yeah, was more on the left and the south. But they did. And there's Woburn in the middle, Mississippi.
It does make sense. I know our company, as we're looking at for, you know, headquarter, and these days they can, with the technology, you can show where your population is, right? And then you can see which areas could make sense, could be better or worse off for your workforce. So I'm not surprised that some of these names are there, because.
I think it's an appropriate list. I just really like to stay consistent. I'd get wary if I was the recipient of hearing all these discussions of compare and have a group
change all the time. Yeah.
That's where I start to question what people are doing with my numbers when they just keep changing.
Yeah. Isn't that a lot we do that goes back and does comparison between different peer groups so that, I mean, you don't. Well, maybe you do. I talk about change in. If you presented the change in Reading versus a change in a peer group over 5 years, you would retroactively go back and change the peer group.
Yeah. You use whatever the current
yeah.
one is. So for all the override analysis, this is the group we use. Well, we can't without Melville.
So you're looking for us to formally add Concord, Lexington?
Yeah, at some point, whenever you're Concord.
It doesn't, the list of peer communities and the averages that we take from there don't tell us what to do with that information. It's not like, okay, Reading needs to target the average. It's all going to depend on what the priorities are.
Well, that's an interesting question. They don't tell me what to do. They tell me what others do.
Okay.
But if you want to be like them, yeah. You know, on the expense side, if you remember, is that in here? Yeah, on page 7, this was Reading versus the peers in terms of how we spent money. And, you know, it's very tight. It's plus or minus a percent. Does that give you information that would make you change how you spend money? I don't know. I'm not not to me. If it was really much more different than this, it might. And then, again, you know, revenues. Take any revenue you get, so.
Yeah.
But it's instructive to know how you're different. Just, you're aware, and there's a couple real simple things, top that are some of the factors, population, medium income. You know, and just to make sure you understand what this says, Reading is 33% higher in population than the state average community. Peer communities are also 33% higher.
Right.
Reading is 31% higher in household income, so are the peers.
Right.
And so on. So you can see, you know, they are pretty similar,
mm-hmm.
two groups.
Mm-hmm.
Reading actually lagged in home value, which I thought was interesting, considering the income is similar.
Oh.
But I should also warn you that data in the municipal sector is far from what it's like in the real world.
No, I understand. No, 100%. No, I was just trying to, you know.
Yeah.
I'm still learning, so I'm trying to apply my day job to some of these things. I was surprising state aid that we had higher than peers on the state aid. Were you surprised?
A lot of kids, students, so that's the reason.
Okay.
You know, we get more Chapter 90, 70, whatever it is.
Chapter 70.
Want to hop down to the next one?
I apologize. I arrived late, so I missed this question. So if I can skip back for a moment, the budget process / schedule.
Mm-hmm.
I noticed that the January 30th date for the Board of Selectmen meeting was not in here. They discussed that at their July 11th meeting of adding that in.
Okay, January 30th. Yeah, I wasn't there, and I reviewed this with them at their next meeting, and they were okay. I think they would like to try to take action on the 24th, if possible, at a financial forum. But, you know, look, the schedule's going to have to be flexible. We all sort of know that. But I do remember that being discussed in this room. John Marina, the decision was not a problem.
They discussed at the meeting, I'm sure it was July 11th, they said the 24th was to collect additional resident feedback, and then if they were able to vote or not, then they have the 30th on the calendar, so for people's planning purposes, they'd be able to know.
Yeah,
it was the 11th, I'd have to check my calendar, but...
So
I think that's going to be an important one that people would want to attend and want to know when it's on the calendar.
Okay. Check that with them. No one noticed that.
I know. I wrote my check tape for second time. Right.
Mm-hmm.
Getting confused
myself. Is this otherwise the same as that previously been circulated, though?
And for your benefit, I don't know if this has been said anywhere else, but John Doherty indicated the schools would probably add another budget meeting somewhere in this January time frame. I think Monday night when they meet, they'll discuss that. I don't know, Saturday night or something. I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
They're already going twice a week, so I'm not sure when. I think he said it might be a Saturday.
Yeah, I think the selectmen gasped a little at a Saturday meeting. So.
Well, we had a meeting in this room earlier with another community with selectmen from both sides. And one of the selectmen from the other community used to be a Reading resident and a town meeting member. And he commented on how the budget process has improved since he was here, because it used to be, I don't remember, the 18 nights. And I remember Peter telling me that when I got here. So going back like 30 years, the budget process took 30 nights of town meeting.
30 nights of town meeting?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
Or not, maybe it was
20. I was going to say, this is looking like a lot of nights.
Yeah.
But no, town meeting.
And I don't
know
what FinCom was like. But every department and division made their own presentation. There was no centralized form of government. There were a bunch of elected boards all fighting for the same money.
Mm.
And that was before Prop 2.5, so there wasn't necessarily a cap.
Mm.
It's like, let's go.
Right. Yeah.
So I can't even imagine. Yeah. Be glad you weren't.
Last man standing
then.
Gets the money.
No, everyone gets the money. That was the problem. But imagine what the FinCom process must have been like, because they had to deal with it all first, and then it went to town meeting. I don't know. Yep. I think the next one is something I think that Sharon discussed with you folks. Your current policies on page 10 and a couple suggestions are on page 11.
Yeah, so we talked about maybe updating the debt and capital policy, because when we had issued debt the last couple times, they highlighted that although we seem to pay off debt in a very short time frame, that nowhere in our policy do we address how we decide to do that.
Mm-hmm.
So the suggestions that were made primarily have to do with that comment itself. Encourages issuing debt for the shortest practical term in order to minimize interest costs. You know, just adding some verbiage that's kind of providing guidance to whoever the treasurer is in his entry. And also that's usually between the town manager and the treasurer that decide. A lot of times how long we borrow, but it wasn't in the policy. And so they kind of, that was a comment that we got both years, is why don't you have some guidance? You know, you seem to do this every year, make decisions and go with a very short time frame, but we don't know that in the future that it will continue that way because the guidance isn't there. So that was kind of some of the reason why that kind of needed to be added. And I think we had something here about just encouraging, you know, taking advantage of refunding. I don't even think we have anything left on the table that we can refund. We definitely have done that. But having it in the policy makes sense. The encouraging of refunding and getting more interest rates wherever possible. Other than that, I don't think there's really all that much need for change.
So these are some suggestions here.
Mm-hmm. So you have the original policy and then the marked up policy that has the change.
Okay, so this is all one recommendation. I'm not looking at, this is recommendation number one versus two. This isn't repeating some of the...
He is taking out, I think Bob marked this up, he took out the net available revenue and just left it as just simply a minimum of 5% of the revenue, just for simplicity's sake. So that's a decision that it's up to you guys if you want to change how that goes.
So from an editing perspective, the fourth paragraph, probably want to take out NAR.
It's deleted as the bottom.
Yeah.
On page 11. I am deleting that paragraph. Net
in the
available revenue.
And in the fourth paragraph of the
report. Oh, does it say that?
Does it say something else?
Yeah, it should just say AR.
Yeah,
it's
NAR.
Just
references. Yeah, it just references it.
Oh,
you just
okay.
Take it out.
Yeah,
see, it says 0.25 of NAR. You just go.
Just revenue.
Yeah.
Just for those that haven't been on FinCom for 100 years, NAR used to be important because we used to borrow debt for projects, and some portion of the debt was the SBAs or the MSBAs. We had to borrow for them as well as us, so they would pay us, and then we would pay off the debt. So it never seemed right in any financial analysis to count that, because it
right.
wasn't really our debt. So we always subtracted it off and said, forgetting that debt, which really shouldn't exist, let's look at ourselves. They don't do that anymore. They pay it off as a lump sum, which is better. So there's no need to have this phrase, or we haven't used it probably for 5 or 6 or 7 years.
I think
years.
When I look at it, though, when we say net available revenue when I'm calculating it for reserves, I think I just don't include what we use for reserves, you know, the overall revenue. But other than that, I used to back out. We had a reserve fund where MSBA was contributing towards the payback of debt. That's all gone now. So it really doesn't have very much value.
Yeah, I mean, the formal definition for the policy was only for MSBA reimbursements or other revenues collected outside the levy.
Okay.
So
maybe I wasn't done with it right.
That's not
time.
The same phrase that you would use as an account.
Yeah.
So, it says if debt service of any new capital project is expected
yeah.
to exceed 25 basis points,
yeah.
the project should then be considered to be debt?
As a debt exclusion or a capital exclusion.
Yeah.
Debt, or, okay,
and
so it still could be debt, but not a debt exclusion, okay.
Yeah, it could be debt, well, it means to say debt or capital parentheses exclusion, so either one would be an exclusion if that's not clear. It should be debt excluded or capital excluded.
Okay.
So if there's a better way to word that, certainly. And that's a little, I guess it's controversial, meaning it means it's interesting, so it's not really controversial, but it's a rule of thumb we followed. If I can can do it in my head, it's like an $800,000 break even for most, you know, short term projects. When I got here from your seats, the town borrowed a lot of money for a lot of reasons. And then just paid it off over 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, whatever, and did a lot of short term borrowing bans before they permanently financed. To me, paying interest is a waste of money. You don't have to. It makes sense.
Today, though.
Yeah. As a portfolio manager, it's used a good thing. But it's a good reason to time shift your payments. For instance, use of a new library should be paid by families over a long period of time. The building's going to be around 50 years. We only borrowed for 10. Even if you had the cash, I don't think it's great to buy it up front from a taxpayer standpoint. But if you're going to buy a fire engine for $600,000 and you could pay it for cash, why do you want to borrow it for 5 or 10 years when you could just put it in as a capital item and be done with it? Once you get in the debt trap, you've got so much money going to debt, you can't do those capital purchases.
Mm-hmm.
But if you wean yourself off, which we've really done a nice job over the last few years, there's plenty of money every year to make a $500,000 or $600,000 purchase. And that way you didn't have to borrow.
It leaves you more flexible.
So aside from our excluded debt, which is, I don't know, I'm going to say average, our inside the levy debt is very low for a municipality. And they said we have shorter maturities than 97% of our peers, even though we don't have a policy that says that.
As a far cry from...
Yeah. So upcoming, we have, you know, Killam, I think, if it ever happens, I think everyone is, that I'm aware of would expect it to be a debt exclusion. However... Barrows was not, Wood End was not, so we have a track record of not doing schools other than the high school as excluded. It's a debatable point. If you just go by math, that's a reasonable finance policy, but our taxpayer is going to pay $20 million for a new DPW garage with the same appetite they'll pay $20 million for a school. The answer practically is probably not. So I like having your policy, but it can't be an ironclad. You know, we can never do anything else because one of the things that I learned from Peter that I really do believe is you ask people to vote on things like capital and debt exclusions when you will do what they say. So if you want to buy a new fire truck and they say no, you're not going to buy a new fire truck until they say yes. Don't ask them if you want to do it anyways. So I think we're much better off buying stuff inside the levy when we think it's as an operational issue, a prudent thing to do, and to leave the discretionary things to the taxpayer. Do you want a new school? There's no way we can afford that, otherwise we have to ask you. There's not a lot of non-building things that we can't buy inside the levy. A ladder truck is now over $1 million. That's coming close to your policy. And, you know, if we were going to buy a ladder truck, God help us, I hope we don't have to. I'd probably come to you and say, no, we want to just put $1.1 million aside. I don't want to have to borrow for that. It's not sensible. But this isn't a bad policy because it makes people really think about, do I want to go to the taxpayer for that big thing?
If you do it, this is probably going to be a stupid question. If you do a debt exclusion, let's say for a ladder truck, do you have to take out debt to pay for it?
You can do a capital exclusion. So you could just say, give me $1 million, I want to buy a fire truck.
Exactly.
And 1 year, $1 million comes in extra, buy the fire truck, no debt. So you can do that.
Okay.
And some communities do that a lot more than we.
Mm-hmm.
I can't remember the last time we did a capital exclusion.
I haven't seen one.
But again, that gets
so
back to
that's different than a debt exclusion, because
yeah.
The debt, you're saying, I'm going to take on debt. I got it.
You know, I want to say like Lexington does lots of those. But again, that comes up to the philosophical question. Are you willing to not buy a fire truck because they said no? I mean, if you need a fire truck, you need a fire truck. You can always wait another year or two or almost always. But
so in that case, does that come from free cash?
No, it's extra taxes for
right.
1 year.
Extra taxes
for
1 year.
Year.
Okay.
Yeah.
So as a taxpayer, it's a fairly simple decision.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Do I want to pay $100 for
mm-hmm.
1 year for a fire truck? Easy thing to understand.
Mm-hmm.
We could definitely shift our approach and be very different than we are.
Mm-hmm.
And we could ask people a lot more often for menu items. I'd wanna have a long discussion before I thought that was a good idea. You know, to the extent you can't get an override passed in your community, we could shift a lot of capital into this philosophical band.
Right, yeah, that's where I'm sort of mentally just thinking.
Right, so.
You know, it is, from a voter perspective, there is some appeal to that, 'cause you know what you're, you know what you're buying.
Absolutely.
Exactly.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So, can I ask a couple of questions? I think you mentioned first that you wanted to inject the language that would say that you could repay, you know, when, didn't you say that?
Yeah, this, on the second page here, you've got the original policy and the second link, the underlined passages are the things we're looking to add, and it says the FinCom also encourages issuing debt for the shortest practical term in order to minimize interest costs. Is that what you're referring to?
Yeah, so, okay, but that's different than repaying.
Yeah.
I thought you said repaying, that, you know, if we have a cash, if we can repay, meaning buy back the debt, I would, no?
No.
No, no, we have the refunding down here too, with, which is when we're looking to like refinance debt and pay it off early.
Okay, so refine, it's different than repay early.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I thought I heard you saying if there was an opportunity to repay the debt earlier.
And yeah, and that's the second addition down below, the FinCom encourages the treasurer to consider refunding and advance refunding any eligible outstanding debt when the savings net of issuance.
So by refunding, you mean repaying?
That's, it's refinancing, it's, you know, it's.
But again, refinance is different than repay.
It's refinancing, I'm just wondering, I never thought of it the way you just described it, but think if you were in our shoes, what source of cash would allow you to go up and buy out debt, buy back debt?
You have to refinance.
An override?
Yeah, you get, okay.
You know,
No, I understand.
It's a really interesting question, I never really thought about it.
That's why I, you know, in my head, I get confused when, because when you said, hey, we wanna be able to repay it, and it makes sense, I was like, yeah, of course.
Yeah, you're trying to buy back debt like a corporation would be.
But you're saying, in order for the municipal to repay, you really have to refinancing with a cheaper debt.
We're refinancing at a lower rate, yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So anytime we have debt that's been on the books for a period of time and it's at a higher interest rate, there's an opportunity for refunding, they call it refunding, it doesn't, it's confusing, but that is exactly.
I think we're on the same page.
Generally, municipalities have to issue non-call 10 years or shorter, but after 10 years, it can be callable.
Okay, and then, my second question is.
You can't call it for the first 8 years.
For the first 8 years.
And then in that two-year window, you can advance refund it, and then you can refund it after year 10, if it's like 20-year debt.
I remember that, yeah, I remember it, yeah, last year.
Did that for the high school.
So why 50,000? How did you come up with the 50,000?
Nuisance value, it's not worth my trip, I don't know.
Well, that's the thing, so from a time, did you, is that, you took?
I think it's above probably what, it's gotta be a significant savings to be worth our time to issue it.
Okay.
I mean, and it costs money to issue debt, so.
Well, it is net of the cost of the issue, so that's good, but then I thought, okay, so there's time that you guys have to spend, and what else goes into?
There's a lot of time that goes into issuing debt.
It is a fair amount of time, there's no magic number about that, you could put in $1.
It's just a guidance kinda number, there's no like hard number behind how we get to 50,000, I think that's just kinda where you start, where is it worth it for us to do this? You know, is it the number large enough for us to consider it?
I mean, in this interest rate environment, it seems like you're not gonna get there.
We don't have anything left.
We've already finished all our.
Yeah.
We've got everything refunded, there's nothing left, sorry.
Yeah.
And our financial advisor, this isn't something I can do in my head, our financial advisor doesn't come to us with anything as small as 50,000, it's not worth their time either, so.
Okay. Those are one of my questions, I don't know if you pointed out the NAR in the middle, okay.
Yeah, we'll change that.
What about in the last paragraph too?
We didn't notice it was there.
I heard her.
The last paragraph came off, the paragraph has it.
Is that NAR too? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, just cross out net available.
What is our debt right now, so, this is not that at any point our debt outstanding would be as a percentage of revenue, this is the project that you're undertaking would be, is that right?
Yeah, there is a figure for that, and there are guidelines for that, but that's not what this policy is. 7.5% of revenue is a rule of thumb. I'll look that up for you. popular one. Last seen 5 years ago, OPEB. I didn't even bother changing it. I just figured we'd just show you the thing we showed you years ago. Let me see. Yeah, it's really pretty simple.
We pretty much have been funding like the 500,000 for a while, but with no real policy saying we should.
Yeah, I mean, this is what we do, what we have done. It's not written down anywhere. 5%. We are actually probably now a little below 5%.
Mm-hmm.
I just looked at the July health insurance. We just got the numbers and it's up like 7 or 8% from last year. And it should be up 4 or 5, so we must have had some enrollment.
Mm-hmm.
Just thought I'd mention that. But our $500,000 is just under 5% now. We're a little above 10 million.
On the enterprise funds OPEB contribution, it says not to exceed 30 years.
Yeah.
Should that be
on track with fully funded well within that?
Yeah, so should
18
it,
years
should this say 30 or should it say by 2036 or something? Because if you keep doing 30 years, then that would be.
I wouldn't want to nail it down to the exact date that it is now because it's hard
to
know.
It's like walking halfway to the wall. You never get there.
But, well, according to this, it should have been 2042. And you're saying that it should be before that.
It was probably done as a 30-year, maybe 6 or 7 years ago. Put on a 30-year schedule, I should say.
The enterprise funds are the only ones we're able to.
Is our MLD on a 30 or a 20-year?
18.
Today?
No, 18 total, I think it was. Or maybe it was 20 to start with, and we're two years into the schedule. Maybe that's what it was. So the water, sewer, stormwater, and RMLD are on a 20-year schedule, and they're able to fully fund the annual required contribution to have it fully funded in that 20 years. The general fund, that annual required contribution to fully fund, is just too large. We're putting 500,000 additional monies towards it, but it's, I think it could be more like $1.5 or $2 million a year to get that fully funded in 30 years. So every time we do evaluation, it resets to another 30 years because we can't cover an annual required contribution until we can. They're going to give us a lower discount rate when we do our valuations. I was told Siegel's working on our OPEB valuation now, and they told us, well, if you're not covering the annual required contribution with all of the changes that have been made, they are only able to kind of give us a 4% discount rate. I think the last time they did it, they gave us 5.75 for the money we put aside. And so we're definitely going to see a much larger number for our liability coming out of this valuation, I believe, because we're going to be allotted a smaller interest, you know, a return that's smaller. They're going to assume a smaller return because we're not putting the annual required in. And every time they do it, they're going to reset to a 30-year for the general fund, meaning since you weren't able to keep up with the payments of the last one, let's start again and do another 30-year model and see if you can get to a point where you can afford that annual required contribution. And then also in fiscal 18, that whole liability will start to show on the balance sheet where it's only been the incremental portion that you haven't been able to fund each year of your annual required has shown on the balance sheet. In fiscal 18, the whole thing will show, and it will just be a nightmarish looking balance sheet, but it is what it is. I think a lot of other towns are in the same situation. So it's one of those things that at least we're doing something, and I think that's a positive. But
where does the OPEB contribution go?
It goes into a trust fund.
And is that managed by the same group that runs the retirement fund, or is no?
We actually wanted to invest it with PRIT, but the legislation was changing that we accepted this at town meeting to create the trust fund. And then there was some parts of the law that were a little bit ambiguous and needed to be changed. And so we were held off until we get a formal trust document in place. And they knew that the legislation was changing. And we recently accepted the most recent updated Section 20 that we had Chapter 32, Section 20, they had updated that section. We re-accepted it because there had been changes, and now I think we're set to actually go into the state retirement, the PRIT fund, to invest our OPEB funds.
So the money right now is just sitting?
It's being invested, but not to the what you would get if you had it in
just
cash.
Cash?
Probably.
Exactly.
Yeah. It's getting
like
smaller.
That. It's a very
yeah.
small return, and so they were very generous to give us 5% or 5.75 is their discount rate that they gave us when they did the valuation last time. I don't think it's definitely not earning that. So forward would be nice, you know, something to kind of commit to, but.
And just so you're aware, I may be the only one in town that believes this, well, Sharon may too, but as part of a future override, as with the past one, I'm gonna propose increased long-term liability funding. Whether it's a faster pension or more OPEB, I don't care. But I think it's irresponsible to have an override without at least having a token amount, $200,000-$300,000 a year at OPEB. Because at some point, someone's gonna look back at how we manage ourselves and say, these guys are out of their minds. Just like we look back at how pensions weren't funded for so many years, dug such a deep hole. So OPEB is not a good situation. Just because we're doing better than most communities, it's not a good situation.
Yeah, the pension one you can't reduce, but OPEB you can just do.
So OPEB's probably a safer thing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Add a couple bucks to.
You can't reduce it, you can't go below the parameters.
But, and if you started putting it in PRT, would you still have the flexibility to put in variable amounts?
Yeah.
They don't care, okay.
So far, there's no legislation.
And OPEB's not mandated to be funded. We are putting money aside, but you don't know how far down the road that mandating of funding is, so.
Yeah.
And in theory, the way we're doing it, and if, even if we increased it, it's subject to April town meeting vote of where it goes. So if you needed it for operations during the year, looking backwards, just because you set it aside for OPEB doesn't mean it goes there until April town meeting says so. So it's always meant to be kind of a health premium buffer, since when you do the budget, you don't always know your health insurance. And only when you don't need it, off you go. But you know, you guys and all of us are gonna face a lot of hard financial decisions in the next few years without an override. Can you really continue to fund OPEB at all? Do you really have to stick to 5% debt and capital? It's gonna be some hard choices ahead. And
it's
the right thing to do in the.
That's a fact, yeah.
What was the comment you made about the balance sheet?
So currently, this liability shows up in the disclosures of the financial statements, and only a portion of it shows on the balance sheet currently. So whatever portion of our annual required contribution that we do not fund, that's, you know, each year that piece gets added to the liability on the balance sheet. I believe it's the fiscal 18 statements, the whole entire liability of, right now it's $67 million will show up on the balance sheet and make a very ugly negative equity.
How much? 60?
I think it's $67 million, the liability overall.
What's the asset, the contra asset on that? Is there any?
Yeah. Well, you mean like the, what do we have in assets? We have like $3 million of assets.
$3 million of savings to offset the cost.
The trust funds are only about $3 million in it, since we've been putting $500,000.
Assets of the people.
So how's that gonna balance?
The beauty of municipal accounting is it never balances.
Is that right?
Not the way he's thinking.
Yeah. It's not what you're thinking, it's a balance sheet.
Debit
well,
credit.
It's just not gonna look right, that's what it's just gonna look funny.
It's no equity account.
Boy, that brings me back.
And the other thing I didn't understand is the funding term not to exceed 30 years, the last piece.
Sorry, where is that?
The last
line.
Not to exceed
30 Usually when we do evaluation, they do a 30-year, they give you an annual required contribution to fully fund a liability within a 30-year time frame. And we always, every time we go for evaluation every other year, they just reset to another 30 years.
Okay.
I mean, for now that we've gone to a point with the enterprise funds, the water, the sewer, the stormwater, and light, that they are able to fund the annual required contribution, we've put aside that money every year. When we do evaluation, they stay with that same chart. So they're gonna be fully funded in 18 years. The general fund's still more than 30 years away because we can't make that in the required contribution.
So do we want to put that number in this enterprise fund section?
The day? I would hesitate to put the exact year because
maybe
if your investments don't do as
well. Yeah, or yeah, say 2037 if it's 18 right now.
Date,
yeah.
But I wouldn't put the exact year that they currently have because it's
yeah, you could say
target.
To target
maybe move up earlier,
to target a full funding
target by a certain date, yeah.
35 or 37.
I wouldn't put the exact year they have on our evaluation, because I see it move a year, back a year, forward a year, just based on performance of investments and such.
What will the funding term target of, and then you tell me what year you want.
And who's responsible for the performance of?
Well, if you can confirm the 18 year, then I would say, 37, give it 20.
We do keep track of those.
If they keep going, knocking it down, then it should move to 20 year.
But who's responsible for?
Yeah, it could be changed.
Yeah.
If it loses value.
Bad years, we'll come back and say, make that 2040.
Yep.
Makes the decisions of where to invest it, but.
So, okay, so your office makes the decision how to invest it? So there's not an investment manager, or there's not a, or is it in a fund?
Well, we want to put it in with Prit, just like, you know, there's a state retirement fund for the OPEB.
Okay, so there are guidelines.
Yeah, we can actually invest with them, but we have to get a trust document drawn up, and we had to re-accept the new section of the law that says that you need all that. So now that we've done that, I think we're on target to actually be able to invest with the state. They kind of were like, okay, we're having issues where they started having people go into that, and they didn't have all of this, you know, an actual formal trust document, and they saw that the legislation was going to change. And so they kind of told us, hold off, you know, there's going to be a lot of changes, you want to make sure you have all of this in place, you don't have to redo any of this. So we've been kind of in a holding pattern for a couple of years, so now I think we probably could move forward.
What's the reason for trust? Sorry for all the questions, but why do you need the trust for this?
I'm not sure, I think it has to do with the fact that you can't take it out.
It's designated for purpose, no.
We can't just decide, it's earmarked for OPEB, I can't take it out for anything of those benefit costs. And so we can't just decide, oh, there's money sitting here and our budget is short, let's take $2 million out of there, no, you can't touch it once.
No, that makes sense, but that's exactly where I was getting at, is it because we actually could as a town go take it if it wouldn't be a trust? Not that we would necessarily, but legally.
We can't take the money out for anything else, yeah.
But also protects it if the town were to go bankrupt or anything like that.
Protects the employees or whatever.
Yeah, they could come after.
Yep.
Yep, okay, that makes sense.
So I rewrote it at Peter's suggestion, the last part of the last sentence, financial staff comma with a funding, the funding term target of 2037.
Which we think is two more years than we've got it going right now, but.
What'd you say?
We think that's two more years than what the target is right now, because you said it's 18.
I think the target is 18, yeah.
Yeah, so it's, yep.
There's a little wiggle room, yeah.
We probably won't have to worry about it for another 10 or 15 years.
It's funny, you feel like that fully funded, it always tends to move it out, though, that's the thing I've noticed, another year, yeah.
Right.
Last two pages, I just thought, since you're looking at policies, I just threw these out there. Finance Committee very many years ago adopted page 14, I don't honestly know the date. And page 15 was more recent, because that was just saying we agree with the Board of Selectmen. I'll call it policy, but I don't really know the policy, it says values. So I don't know what FinCom wants to have in this sense, I think it's a good idea to make some sort of statement, whether you have a mission statement or guiding principle, what you call it, I don't know. This is helpful for just a resident to look at the website and see a summary of what is FinCom doing. So I hadn't looked at this in a very long time, so I was just looking at the website.
When was it last, you know, when it was last amended?
More than 10 years.
Really?
Well, the Selectmen one is a little less than 10 years, probably 8, but the other one is longer than I know about.
Has anything changed recently you can think of that worthwhile? Have we taken on more responsibility lately? From your perspective?
Offhand, the list on page 14 seems fine. I'm just also thinking of the charter process we went through where there were some changes, but FinCom's basic purpose certainly did not change. I guess guess if I were a resident looking at this, one area that I wouldn't be clear on is what is your role with respect to RMLD? And the answer is none, unless they issue debt. So I don't know if that's worth mentioning. People in the community think RMLD is just one of our departments. You know, they pay bills out in the mailbox, so. A lot of them don't even know there's another bill. But if you haven't heard those comments, it's not broken, then probably fine.
So there's no proposed changes to this one?
I just put it out there only because I was guessing, I hadn't seen it in many years, I was guessing it's not something that's been discussed in many years.
Yeah, yeah.
I also found a 1996 cash reserves policy, if you want me to send that to you.
Oh, really?
I didn't print it out, but I didn't put it in.
Oh.
That was Beth Clef Heiss from way before me, on FinCom meeting.
Right. What did it say in general?
A little less than what you say now, but the same basic idea.
Okay.
Yeah, less tools.
I just didn't live by it, probably.
Yeah, no. And lastly, you did a renew of the cash reserves policy last August,
mm-hmm.
a slight revision. I just put it in there to be complete. From that discussion, I'll come back to you with a little more peer community sort of data, if you like, and whatever else you want to ask for. And we do owe you surplus property discussion next time. And Sharon, I think Gail was intending to come. Your next meeting is the September Financial Forum.
Mm-hmm.
There's not a lot of topics other than a couple of things we mentioned tonight, plus school revolving funds. I know
right, that was
a question about her.
Yeah, she's on vacation, so,
so whether you whether you wanted to do that theoretically before, but maybe a little better after a financial forum. Financial forums generally don't last long.
Mm-hmm.
You know, especially the first one. An hour, maybe an hour and a half. You know, Sharon's not gonna have much to say about things in September. You know, we can give you a real high level budget guidance, but it's only that. It's and John and I already talked about it. It's almost not the same because it's so early, honestly.
Mm-hmm.
But October has got to be nailed down. I think September was more meant to be a discussion with FinCom, Selectmen, School Committee, Library Trustees, if they want, about the budget process, strategies for, you know, publicity or whatever you want to call it.
Mm-hmm.
The selectmen finalized a survey last night, which they would like to have the results available for the October financial forum. So that's not even on the September financial forum
mm-hmm.
schedule.
So you're thinking the revolving funds on the 20th?
I think in September, the revolving funds.
Is it right there? Sure, because there's
it's
not a lot
gonna
to
be,
in September.
Unless you guys
it's
can think
you
of
have
things.
All the boards are even to review the calendar again, you know,
yeah.
because
mm-hmm.
we have all the boards and. Hopefully all separate meetings. It's
oh, and so you know, for the financial forums, the first one is in the library downstairs, the new conference room. The second one is at the Scatini Library in the high school. I'll put this down in a document, and then the last one is back at the library. The library's busy in the middle one. And the selectmen have booked for all their December meetings the library. The school committee was still trying to debate where to do their meeting. So we're generally using the library for all these budget meetings for the town and mutual events, except for the one that wasn't available. We just wanted to make sure that if there's people interested, they'd have room. And especially when you think of who's coming to the December selectmen's meeting, you know, you potentially have two elected boards, you guys, lots of department heads, plenty of volunteer boards that may or may not show up. You're gonna have a pretty full room even before the general public might have any interest, so, you know, we've gotta get a bigger space. This certainly wouldn't work. We didn't really think the senior center was big enough either.
The library room is that much bigger than the senior center?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's also wired better for RCTV. If you open up the full room, it's either 120 or 125, I don't remember.
Yeah.
The senior center's not 100, not that it's that different. Senior center's not a comfortable 100 either. It gets a little tough.
I think the other piece of information we're looking for from the last meeting, you know, as we transferred additional over time was, you know.
Oh, I know.
Yeah, overtime monies, FTE, you know, year by year, and how much money we've then transferred from free cash throughout the year.
Sharon has that. Now, the thing I remember you asking, and the chiefs are both, I think, ready in September to give a discussion about staffing and wages and FTEs and overtime. A year ago or 2 years ago, I don't remember, this question came up. You were one of the people asking. You weren't the only one, and I don't remember. We gave you some kind of explanation on a piece of paper saying, here's what's going on in the fire department. So all we have to do is refresh that. It's simple in some ways, and then kind of not always simple. Let's say there's three wage lines, whatever they are, and then there's overtime. If you only look at overtime, that's not seeing the full picture, because what if you have vacant positions? There's a vacancy up above in those three lines that's causing overtime to be used. So you really have to look at the whole package in some way, or make an adjustment to overtime,
right, of actuals,
because of vacancies.
You're saying,
overtime,
you have to look at
could
actuals.
Be negative, but you could have,
yeah,
a line
salaries
item where
could be budgeted here,
there,
but the actual,
yeah,
was less,
so
because you just have the
looking
overtime.
At only overtime, especially in fire,
mm-hmm,
but also in police, can be very misleading.
Yeah.
You know, fire is up in the $500,000-$600,000 range. I can't remember, but netto of savings off of salary budget, it's really, that's the number you. And we'll make sure,
right,
you have all the
numbers. Okay, because you know, okay.
Yeah.
So you'll,
we
want to
do that
know
for September then, right?
Yeah.
The 20th
just
meeting? I totally forgot about it, to be honest. I apologize.
It's not the, yeah, that's right. I'm sorry. I might have said another date, September.
So
20th.
Like for the last 5 years, kind of.
5 years.
At least.
So kind of maybe we show you like the salary for fire and police, and you see all the line items and then what the,
yeah,
transfer
is.
Right, so you
already
want to be budget and actual.
What else would you
want to
alleviate?
Since you guys asked questions, and honestly, I thought it was interesting, I asked them to survey the 25 peer communities and get staffing levels and get overtime use.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Let's just really go at it.
Yeah.
We all learn from it, so I don't know what we'll learn.
All right, because we're always struggling with what sort of, what's that optimal FTE number?
Right, especially fire.
Yeah. Greg and Mark are getting that information.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, they've already, you know, one of them's almost done surveys, the other is halfway through. That's related. I don't think so. If there's something else that you wanted to discuss within the town, I only heard fire and police.
Yeah,
that's
okay.
Helped. Okay. You guys have a good understanding based on, at least last year's budget process, the hiring process of firefighters and police officers.
Yeah, it was discouraging.
Yeah.
Surprising.
You know, respectfully, it's not the same as, oh, we need a teacher. Let's go hire a teacher. Okay,
mm-hmm,
we got one.
Mm-hmm. No, that was very enlightening.
Yeah. There's a lot of planning that goes on in those departments, and no matter what you plan, it never works out exactly right, but at least you've thought about a lot of things and you're ready to do certain things. You know, it's not as easy to forecast retirements as it once was. You could always predict firefighters 32 years out they go. There's an age maximum they have to go by, 65. So if they started as an 18-year-old, 32 years is a maximum pension, 50, they're gone. Different people have different appetites for keeping working. They're not technically earning much more pension. And then some people leave sooner, so it's just, or transfer, it's just not easy to do. But, you know, the one thing you can be sure of is each department is always going to have some vacancies. It's almost inevitable. Whether it's someone's injured.
Yeah, unless you overstaff, in which case you've got another
Yeah, what I would really like to know is, and it's gotta be a math answer, we've debated this for a few years.
Yes.
No one's hurt, no one's retiring, here's your workforce, no one calls in sick, how much overtime do you need from vacation? If everyone takes their maximum vacation, there is a mathematical answer to that, I don't know what it is. Cause the reality is so different than that, it's like, what do you mean? I don't know how to do that. But I'll take a crack at it, cause that would be a really interesting baseline. Look, the fire department has X number of dollars that is a baseline minimum, just based on vacations. And it's guaranteed it's not gonna be lower than that, assuming everyone takes vacations.
Unless you have more on each group.
Exactly.
So that you don't need minimum manning if you've got like an extra person on each.
They have rules about who can take vacations, so that shouldn't technically be a problem if no one's sick and no one's out for any other reason. Only two on a vacation at a time. Now, I've never studied the math to see, can you actually impose that policy and everyone can take as many vacation days as they are due? I don't know. That's another math that no one's actually ever done.
But they have the bare minimum, they have the minimum manning for each, right?
They're staffed over minimum.
Oh, so they have a floater that can cover when people are on vacation, so they don't have overtime?
12 numbers.
I guess that's what I was confused about.
Depending on how you look at it, they have two or three per group extra.
Oh, okay.
So their cushion's pretty good superficially. But then you always have to subtract two for a number of reasons. But, you know, I've asked them, let's do some of this math. If it just doesn't make sense, we
I think we gotta play with blocks or something.
And then
some Montessori kind of techniques on showing the staff.
Okay, here's your firefighters.
You get into police and it's different. There isn't contractual minimum manning, but there's minimal emotional manning, like I would never want to do this. But that partly depends on the chief and the community and the circumstances. But I think you guys would feel a lot more comfortable if you had a deeper understanding of this once and for all. I mean, I thought a couple of years we pretty much hit it, but the more I thought about it and heard your discussion, I said, yeah, there's another level down that we really have to dig so that you can really build this from the bottom up. Open the doors, run a department. This is what it's gonna cost you before anything goes wrong. Here it is. And then here's some of the cushion for things that
And he always has injuries because it's such a physical job.
And you're right, the randomness of the timing of things is what hurts you. You know, it's just like trying to redistrict schools. If only all the kids would spread out equally among all the grades and all the neighborhoods, we'd be fine. But they don't.
Just like communism, all that sort of stuff.
Yeah, central planning.
Yep. And benefits are not really carved out separately because overtime costs more, but
right.
You don't have the additional benefits.
Right, no, that's just all off to the side. Anything
else?
Yeah,
but if you hide another person, there's always the cost of their benefits.
The cost is 100.
More than just their salary that you're paying.
Anything else you can think of for the financial form, shoot me an email, shoot Sharon an email anytime you think of it. And then in October, I know we'll have a real budget discussion. It's a little early, but I know we can do it. We have to. What did we do last year? Do you remember? Was it one? Funny, I don't remember.
What, in terms of financial form?
Was it 1.75%?
For what? Oh, for the
one and a half?
Oh, what for the COLA?
No, the FinCom budget guidance.
Oh, it was
1.5. It's
1.5.
It's really funny.
1.5 or 1?
No, that's
like bad.
I think it was 1.5.
I think it was 1.5. It should be better next year. I can say that pretty comfortably. And we already said that a year ago that this would be the tough year, the 1 year adjustment, then it would be a little better.
Right.
It's not good by any stretch, but it's not as terrible.
Not as painful.
As it was.
And why is that again?
Because we cut down the use of free cash from $2 million to $1 million or whatever it was, so that adjustment alone was painful.
Yeah, the year before was $2.2 million of free cash, and then we went down to $1 million or $1.2 million. We ended up with $1.2 million because it was $1.1 million, and then we added the other $100,000 back to the school.
Oh, yeah, right.
So we went down $4 million, so that's a decline in your reserve use.
Oh, it's sort of like the acceleration versus
speed. Yeah, because you had that 2.2 and now you're using 1, yeah.
When will you
have to
know
make up for it somewhere?
Final number for the year, whether it was
for free cash?
Yeah.
Anytime soon.
The numbers are still moving.
Maybe by the October financial.
Right.
Wow.
By
maybe
October,
not.
Right. Yeah. I might be able to at least, if I don't have a final number, I might at least be able to give you an estimated number.
What do you have an indication in terms of knowing?
No. We're still processing bills for fiscal 17, which just keep rolling in. So it's hard to know where
talking
to
free cash or certified.
Stop moving.
And where are we at?
Yeah.
Where is municipal and schools at on contracts?
Are they all negotiated?
We have all completed 1-year contracts. The school committee has not fully ratified them. They'll do it Monday night. So
but they're also doing 1 year. So all 1 year.
Everyone did a 1 year. Yeah.
Mm. Is that just because of the uncertainty?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, and it wasn't.
So is that really painful to them?
Well, the question is, what do we do next?
Huh?
He has to sit on the
You know, we did 1 year after knowing in October we didn't have an override. Now, there was some uncertainty as to whether last April another one would come back 6 months later. You know, I don't know. It wasn't so sensible to me, but there's definitely discussion.
So then are the contracts pretty much the same as what they were?
I mean, you know, every union was treated a little differently, but.
And contracts are public after
this? Yes, they're already up on our website.
They should be on the website.
I think one of them's not because it's not signed yet, but our stuff's already up. Look under our human resources department or division. And
yeah,
all the schools will be there, but they're the old ones still.
On our website, and they should all be there.
And then are the school ones on the website after?
They will be there when their school committee takes action on Monday, and then they're all
signed.
And
then they should be up there.
When you say they're up there, do you mean literally the whole contract's
on there?
The whole contract should be on
there. All
the
steps and stuff.
Yep.
And we've always had them on the website like that?
For a while.
I believe so,
yes. I don't know about always, but yeah, it's been for a while.
Very transparency.
Yeah. My contract's there too, if you really want to enjoy it. It's a little shorter. We'll just work hard. We'll pay them what we can afford.
Drips of blood.
Yeah, that stuff's all public, and it's, you know, we're
always. Public's
in.
Different than actually.
But I guess
it out
I don't
there.
Think that other. I don't think people know.
I was
going to
say, we're interested,
yeah,
obviously,
yeah.
in what other towns pay unions, and it's not easy to find.
Right.
It's not always on websites.
Oh.
So.
That's interesting. I would think
yeah.
it would be, since it is a public record, you would think it'd be out there.
So, this may sound stupid, but we don't check on a monthly basis or so how we're doing against the budget.
We do, but I can't, if the numbers don't start moving in terms of the expenses, I couldn't tell you how much will be left over to turn back to free cash. Because I don't know what's still going to come in. I can give you an idea of maybe revenues, but I certainly can't give you, you know, what we're, if we're, you know, we're budgeted and we have less that we spend in expenses, that's what's going back to free cash.
Yeah. So on the revenue side, you have an indication.
It's moving too much right now for me to even give you a thought.
Moving too much in terms of.
There's a lot of things that have to happen. First,
it's getting settled.
Yeah, there's
settled
bills that
accounts.
Are still being processed for fiscal 17. There's payroll accruals that need to be done because that first payroll that hits in July needs to be done by journal entry to put back into 17, the portion that relates to 17. So.
But you know about them, it sounds like.
Yes, I know about them.
So
yes.
Sharon could pretty well figure out the payroll if she had to manually. Expenses she can't because
I don't really know what's
departments
coming. I don't know what they haven't told
what
me or what they
sorry I don't mean I just want to understand so when you say you don't know what's coming means
let's pretend I'm a department head I've encumbered funds and said I'm going to spend $50,000 on something and I've even given it a name she doesn't really know whether I have or haven't spent it until an invoice comes in and I might have said geez I forgot to cancel that so it really does take a while even though so we know we can't spend more than was there because that you know, that's impossible
Yeah,
but we might spend less because oh cripe, someone forgot to cancel that purchase order or that encumbrance. We had money available, we forgot about it, and she doesn't have any.
But you just
to
said you
that.
Do it versus budget on a monthly basis, so you know if you spend
that
budget.
That.
But it's not it's not like everything that comes in is done every month, you know what I mean? Like, and sometimes I feel like the DPW stuff lags a lot, and that is some of the biggest bills that you'll see coming through for paving and things of that nature. So I would hesitate to give you a number.
Yeah. No, not to ask you for
all
I'm
that
just,
stuff is in there.
I'm just
you
trying
want
to
the system
understand
to
the process.
Do its thing and
yeah,
not.
Yeah, I want to know that everything,
like manually
I'm not
to
accepting any more
fiscal
gonna... 17 bills, and then that number is a final number, because if I estimated it and I was wrong, I would mislead you, so I really would.
Yeah, my guess is you could estimate, say, 90% of the lines, but that's nowhere near 90% of the money.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a couple big things that stick out there that you just can't know.
And you know, you highlighted typically what are the, you know, which lines are on the revenue side that, hey, you can come over, and on the expense side, which
even,
are the ones that you can.
Even things like school teachers, I'll get time to accrue in
yeah.
August, like that they worked in June. Like, how in the world did this not get to me by now? So there's a lot of things that happen late.
Yeah.
So I tend not to give a number until I feel really comfortable things are slowing down in the movement and that we've got it. And there is quite a bit still going through for fiscal 17, so I don't want to mislead anyone.
And as a result, not to really complicate things, but as a result, the first month of the year, it's really hard to know what's going on because we're still from an accounting system in the last year. So we might keep track ourselves what's going on. She can't know it, and none of us can know as a group until she says, all right, the year's done, now we're in the year, now you can see it.
You can see fiscal 18's budget, but it's kind of like
see the budget,
it's like the
hard.
System thinks you're in fiscal 17
yeah.
until I close it. So that's the live and active month until I close it.
Yeah.
But both of them are running. They're separated and you can see them, but.
You would never run a business this way.
No. I'm still trying
makes
to process.
Makes it more interesting, though.
It's actually a lot of work because I get bills coming
yeah.
upstairs for both years and we have to keep them separate. You cannot commingle the funds.
Yeah.
It really makes
yeah.
a lot of work at this
you
time.
You earmarked them.
How important is your fiscal year end?
How important is it? Important.
Yeah, but you've got cushions in there with accruals and everything else. And
yeah.
you really don't do
yeah.
accruals. It's
fiscal,
more cash
when
basis.
The day after the fiscal year happens, how certain are you that you know what went on? Reasonably certain.
You mean once it ends?
It's January 1st.
Yeah, we don't have anything.
You have a pretty good idea of what the prior year did compared to what she just told you.
I gave him 2 weeks.
Okay, well, that's what I'm asking.
Yeah, 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, it's 2 months.
Yeah.
That's
I'm
kind
the
of the
only
difference.
One doing it all. But
yeah.
yeah, the other girls that are up there, they're paying bills, they're paying payroll.
Yeah.
Nobody else is doing actual accounting work. So. When I worked in private, we closed a month and 3 days because
well,
we had CPAs and we were all working overtime to get it done. It doesn't happen that fast here. There's a lot
I'll,
to look
I'll
at.
I'll take it
now.
Back because we already know 11 months out of 12, we know how well we've done versus budget. So,
yeah,
last
but
month,
you're
so
able to use accruals and reserves versus.
Yeah. Well, that's why I'm trying to understand the process
mm-hmm.
to see what's, you know.
In an ideal world, that when they're making purchases and they're signing contracts, they should be putting in requisitions that holds money against their budget so that the manager knows what in real time what they have left. What I've seen in some departments is sometimes they're doing those requisitions when the bills come in. It's like, well, then you're not helping the manager manage their budget.
Mm-hmm.
If you, I'm like, don't even bother with the PO at this point. You've got the bill, just pay it straight. You know, don't, you know, because you're wasting time. The whole idea is that you give the manager the opportunity to, number one, say yes or no, do I want you to purchase this against my budget? And then number two, they're holding the money on your budget so you can look and say, my available amount that I have for my budget is this. If you don't actually hold it at the time you order whatever it is you're ordering or sign that contract, then you're not helping the manager know exactly what they have left to spend. And so that's why I hesitate. I see too much of why are you doing a requisition when you have the bill in front of you? Just pay the bill. You know what I mean? It's already you've already gotten the merchandise. Any option that the manager has to say no, I don't want to make this purchase is pretty much
null now.
You know, so the couple things that in an ideal world, I would say 90% of people will do the requisition, are required to do the requisition, and some of them do when they get the bill. And so it's hard for me to know what's out there where they didn't actually do the requisition and I'm going to get slammed with the bill. Sometimes I have to bring them to town meeting because if they don't actually give me if they don't actually requisition it and have a PO at year end that brings the money forward, and then it comes in and I've already closed the year, I can't commingle the years. I have to go to town meeting and tell town meeting, I have a bill for $5,000 from the prior year, and there's no money brought forward for it, so I have to ask permission to pay it, and I have to hold it until
that
I have permission to pay it.
Over
yeah.
budget, basically.
Yeah, so it's basically like, yeah, you don't, the budget is closed out to free cash. There's nothing left to pay for the appropriate year. So I try and keep it open as long as I can to make sure that I get all of that.
Well, that's true, so that's one, but what if the budget was, actually all of the budget was used, this would technically be...
We don't normally have it, you know, we usually monitor our budgets enough that we're asking for money at town meeting, we're asking a FinCom reserve fund transfer, if we're seeing that, you know, every department head should be monitoring their budget, but Bob's looking, I'm looking, you know, we're always maintaining, hopefully that doesn't happen, but it could happen, obviously, because
before
we don't know what's out there, really, so...
Before we changed our accounting system...
It happened a lot.
It was 10 years ago. You couldn't know. You'd look at what you could know was, oh, through 11 months we spent about this much, and then it would be like a food fight at the end, and everyone, you know, there'd be $1,000 left, and four people would spend it. Whoops.
Right.
And so then they overcorrected and said, well, there's really nothing left because we might all spend it. It was just completely random. No one knew. With our current accounting system, it's much better. As long as you plan and do purchase orders or requisitions for things that you expect to plan or spend, then no one else will spend that money. And then the much more common thing is, geez, I forgot that I planned to spend that. I didn't end up needing it. And that's why we turn back more money than you
expect.
Because
they'll hold it with the PO and then they change their mind. Maybe the merchandise comes in and they said, I don't, this isn't what I thought. They send it back. They get a credit on it and then they close the PO. I won't know that until they do that and the money just goes back to free cash.
A pretty good example of something you should know is DPW rubbish, you know, recycling. At the beginning of the year, more or less right around now, they'll put out purchase orders for the whole year because we have a contract. We know what it's going to cost. We don't know the exact volume, but we have history,
mm-hmm.
so we have a pretty good idea. There's a couple small pieces that are much more variable, so maybe it could be 50,000, but let's put 100,000 in. And then they forget about that item until... I might look at it just before May town meeting. They might look in June. Oh yeah, how did that work out? Usually there's extra because they were careful. What if the volume's a little higher? What if this happens? And all of a sudden there's 50 or 75,000, which for its purpose doesn't seem like a lot. But boy, in other departments, if we knew there was $50,000 around, we could have done this.
Yeah.
But for a $2 million rubbish contract, you know, 50,000 is reasonable. So this tool allows us to have these discussions, but again, you ever saw the volume of stuff that she goes through and consider we have one accountant? It's really not easy to be as efficient as you might like.
Thank you for your service.
Yeah, a lot of it, even though we have good technology, a lot of it is still manually. And Sharon and I have to look over, in theory, every school department and every RMLD invoice.
That's 30,000 bills a year.
So,
oh.
You know, both have to, we both sign all
they both have
money
to look
spent,
at all that every
you know, all those three departments. So.
And I look at all the receipts too, and there's 120,000 a year. So there's a lot going on. So it's not like we're, you know, it's a lot to go through, and then we don't have a deep staff where there's a lot of people to do all this. You know, to make sure that we're checking for fraud. Like when a turnover comes into the collector's office and the school department says I've turned over $1,500, they give me a copy and then I match it up with what they post and I make sure that $1,500 was posted, you know, that what they turned over matches. So we're doing things to make sure that money isn't walking out the door too, so it's a lot.
Thank you.
So revised committee assignments, nobody had any other problems with those?
Oh, I also just wanted to also
Yes. This came out better. Yeah, the one I printed out came out like that too. Must have been scanned.
Yeah, some kind of that.
I report out of scan, first copy.
Oh, that's right.
So it's just got one.
Services.
So, library is the board of prestige for the library, so I've been on that.
Did you do that?
I've been on that one for 2 years, but I punted because I took the board of selectmen and schools, we have both.
They're huge, yeah.
And so.
Oh, yeah, now we're all.
We're all gonna go to all those anyway.
So, yeah, but
Sounds like it.
The library doesn't meet very often.
Okay.
Well,
they, so as part of this, will some of these things that we're on, will these people reach out to me, they have my email, will they let me know which meetings I'm on?
What ones do you want?
So library, retirement board, administration.
Retirement board, I can have Colleen start to send you an agenda for that, and then you can come as you feel that you want to or you have time to.
Were you on that before, who was on?
No, I was just gonna say that I don't get the update, or I don't get agendas from board of selectmen, but I do from the schools, so I think everyone operates a little bit differently with respect to their FinCom liaisons.
It's written, whatever you guys want, we can figure out a way to do it. I wasn't sure you had finalized your list yet, so I didn't want to.
Yeah, the retirement didn't used to be, didn't used to have a representative, I went to one meeting last year, and I thought it was good, so I thought we should cover it, because it is a pretty good chunk of the budget, so.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
Yeah, as long as, you know, people send emails with agendas and.
So this is a final list then?
Yeah, I guess so, and I assume you guys know a couple of these are departments, and I don't exactly know, you know, finance, that's Sharon, you know. She can write you to come check once in a while.
But there was a big problem, yeah, we don't normally have meetings, but there's a problem that.
And I think Brendan, you explained a couple of them too, so administrative services.
Yeah, that's like our department, the town manager, HR.
They would.
Operations.
And they may sometimes directly go to Peter, go to the.
Well, because I know that Bob will usually talk.
Right.
Yeah, but you wouldn't really have a lot of interaction, I mean, it's technology, HR, yeah, operations, you know, maybe, it's not FinCom stuff so much. Now, let me just look, public works, no, not public works, you have those, public services, do you have that somewhere?
Yeah, I've got that.
Well, there it is, Paula, that's, you know, 10 boards or 15 boards or whatever it is. I don't know, as we get into the budget, and if we start slicing and dicing like happened in the past, then yeah, there, you definitely wanna go to different meetings and see what's up, but I'm not forecasting that this year, hopeful. Oh, and I wanted to give you an update, there isn't one, but I wanted to tell you, there isn't an update on RMLD, that instructional motion about the dividend. I heard, again, secondhand somewhat at the selectmen's meeting, I just wasn't paying attention, I was doing something else, that the CAB has been unable to meet to talk about it yet. RMLD board is ready to do it, but the citizens advisory board, which is two members from Wellington and one each from the other three towns, including Reading, just has not been able to arrange their calendars yet to meet with RMLD commissioners and advisors.
But they're still trying to get that scheduled then?
Yeah, and I don't have any idea what they will discuss or won't discuss, just so you know, that's not a dead topic, it's just have nothing has happened.
RMLD makes payments to all the towns, right? Not just us.
Well, they make one set of payment to all the towns, including us, but the payment really under discussion is only made to us is, I call it a dividend, I don't know what the legal phrase is.
Oh, a dividend distribution.
Yeah, because we're their owner. They make, I don't know, you call it a payment in lieu of taxes maybe to the other communities?
They do.
Okay.
We call it a payment in lieu of taxes.
That's a much, much, much smaller number. That's not, I don't think, under discussion.
Why do we pay the other communities that? I never understood.
Again, I assume it's because we're not taxing their property. You know, they have equipment. So I beyond that, it's a Victor question.
Oh, I guess that makes sense.
If it's a public utility, whatever, they'd be paying a tax on the poles and everything else.
Yeah.
So, I don't know what they're worth, but.
Yeah.
Use telephone pole?
Yeah, right.
slightly used.
Yeah, Paul, if you wanna get on, you know, half a dozen, a dozen mailing lists for all the boards, you can, and then you can decide what you like. You want me to just do that and see what you think, and then get off them if you don't like it, that's fine.
Yeah, and
most of those boards meet once a month, some of them meet twice a month. Finance is almost never discussed at any of them, but.
Yeah.
Make sure you get added. And permanent building committee is, that's Joe Huggins, mostly does that, our facilities director. Try to go to that.
I might.
I'll try to.
Email Joe, I just, that was the one I was more.
Yeah.
Side.
They're, I think they're also meeting once a month. They're targeting November town meeting to do a partial report and then April to finish it up in the conditions of buildings. That's one of their missions, is to give an update to town meeting every year on the condition of buildings. So they're actually physically meeting in each building in town and walking around.
Oh, and that's what they've been focused on right now, ever since the cemetery thing.
They may be doing other things too, but I know they've met in two schools lately, for instance.
They're gonna give recommendations of things they.
I think they're gonna just give an update to town meeting, whatever that means. You know, a building needs to be replaced.
Email Joe for agendas, that always helps to go, okay, let's see. Got something there.
Bob, I have a question. At the Board of Selectmen meeting this week, you discussed an economic development meeting on October 4th. Was that already tackled during the?
I can't remember. Before the meeting started, I think I might have just said a couple words, but on October 4th, which I believe is a Wednesday, at the library downstairs in the big conference room, we are doing an economic development forum that I would urge at least a couple of FinCom members to come to. You know, that's the revenue side, which isn't traditionally something you guys would look at, but I still think as finance people tell town.
I know, I think that's got more relevance than some of the.
Kind of.
It does, because, you know, where we've got the town manager model, some of the individual, you know best, so I feel like some, that almost makes more sense having a liaison for economic development than some of these departments.
I think that's an interesting point. I think, first of all, it's more interesting than most other things we do. It just generally is. It's important, it's the future of the town. It's not the nuts and bolts today, but it's big picture. Now, I will tell you, based on other communities, if we had the opportunity set that some of them have, I would say it's incredibly important.
Right.
We just don't have the same opportunity, so I can't say it's incredibly important, but it is important. I will tell you, the one thing our economic development director has done is absolutely put us on the map with virtually every developer. You know, if we had land to build on, they'd all be building. It's easy. They now know where Reading is. They know we're a destination in their eyes in a lot of ways. He's really very effective. So he'll bring them to the October 4th meeting. They'll sit in the back with sunglasses and mustaches on, because they don't want to get up and talk. They're competitors and whatever, but they want to see.
Hmm.
All right, I know what this guy's like. Maybe I met the town manager or some other staff, but let me just see what the community's like.
Hmm.
So it would be interesting. What I did mention earlier is there's a couple of projects that the town will get an update on October 4th that are interesting. I will tell you that the post office got approved by Mass Historic last week, so that was a big hurdle. So the post office will be redeveloped. Commercial on the bottom floor, residential up top. That old Haven Street will start moving again.
Okay.
So they're gonna be restricted as far as what they can change, but they can.
There are definitely some restrictions, but the developer's done a really very creative job and kept going back to the well as they kept asking for more. And it's really a very attractive thing. It's not out of place. It's not out of scale. It's big, but it's not bad. And you know, if you guys that have been here a while think back to 7 or 8 years ago when the downtown was still, MF Charles building had all scaffolding around it. And if you even go back a little further, the Atlantic was still here, abandoned or a hole. You know, the place looks a lot better. You know, we really have come a long way. And in development and in planning, you know, 5 or 10 years is not a long time. That's yesterday. And that's the frustrating part, is when we see to the future, we see some things happen, we see it for a while. think I'll be able to do X. It's like, really? Because, yeah, here's all my hurdles. So, okay. So, and that's fast track. That's something that I know about. So it's hard. But I do think you'll enjoy going on October 4th if you can, or watching it afterwards. It'll
now, if we go on the town website, are we able to request getting emails for agendas for the different groups? Is that an...
Is
that a possibility?
The old website, you could do that. I don't think that's possible. I don't know. I'd have to check.
Oh, okay.
You can find people in departments and ask
them.
They add you to the distribution
yeah.
So that's what I'll do. Like for retirement board, I sit on that board. I'll reach out to Colleen.
And I'll just do that with department heads.
Just have them add.
What I normally would do is, once I know you guys are all set with this, I'd send this to department heads and say, look, here's the list. You go contact people
yeah.
who are on the list and see what they want.
Right, especially when you're looking for advocacy, yeah. Play with our website again. I'll try and do that once in a while.
Yeah, Paul is always good at getting the audit committee people on.
How do you get them to meet? How do you get them to meet the audit committee?
Oh, Paul.
Paul was doing
Paul.
It.
Oh. I don't know.
I was thinking
most
about
impossible
Paula Skinner.
Oh, okay. Oh, you said Paula. I think
yeah, Paula Skinner
gotcha.
Used to do it. Now she's retired, so
yeah.
Poor Caitlin is going to have to try and find a way to get us all together. Because it's a big group, just to get a day that everybody's able to meet and get a quorum. And that's actually coming up soon, too. Because they're done with the financials, so I'm sure they'll be looking to schedule. Did they approve the minutes?
I was actually going to mention the ATFC. For those that don't have enough meetings on their schedule, their annual meeting's October 21st. I've been to a couple of them, and they're pretty good meetings, actually. Different work sessions and everything, so people might want to consider. It's down in Franklin, which is a bit of a hike.
Yeah, I haven't seen the agenda yet. Oh, here it is. That'll be out in August.
Yeah. Just high-level topics, but...
I'm really curious what Finance Committee potpourri is.
Yeah.
My guess is it's the guy from Arlington that's been chairman of their Finance Committee for 25 years or something.
Right.
Yeah, Reading is unusual in having term limits for a Finance Committee. Hmm. Actually have not seen that anywhere else.
Really?
Oh,
why was that instituted?
I don't know. It was with a charter.
Huh.
20 whatever years ago.
Wow. I thought it was the norm.
No. No, as Peter says, there's people that have been on finance committees and the chair for like 25 years. So I guess if it works. Yeah,
where
fine.
Was this last time? Was it in Waltham?
I didn't go to the last one. I went to the one before, and that was out in Sturbridge.
Does it change? Rotates?
Yeah.
Is this in Franklin?
I went to the one before that, but I forget where that was.
It's good to go to that stuff, but it's hard to learn a lot of new stuff that you
yeah.
can come back with. When we go to conferences, and it's good to go because of the people you meet, but in terms of the content, more often than not, we learn, oh, yeah, we're doing okay, whatever the topic is, you know, which is also good to learn.
Are we under the minutes?
I think so.
I'll make a motion to accept the minutes of 6/28/17 as written.
Second.
Discussion. No discussion. Shall we have a vote then? All in favor? Opposed? You and one abstention? Okay. So 5-0 with one abstention.
The history of FinCom, we've only had one vote against minutes.
Yeah.
About 18 years, I'm here.
Why would somebody vote against minutes?
I'm not gonna say who, but it was someone's last meeting, they said, you know, I'm just gonna vote against these minutes.
Is that your idea of entertainment, Bob?
It wasn't me, no, it wasn't me.
You planting.
I was here, on this side.
I heard you were fun.
I was on this side of the table when it happened. Are you folks more comfortable meeting at 7 or 7:30? I try to ask every so often, okay, 'cause
Seven thirty.
Most boards meet at 7, but FinCom is always one at 7:30, 'cause there's a lot of people coming out of Boston, so, okay.
Yeah.
Now, financial forum, same thing. So those have been requested to be at 7.
By whom?
Board of Selectmen and School Committee, 'cause that's when they meet.
Just it's personally, it's easier to get home from work.
But they also don't go.
Well, however, the first financial forum.
Get to bed and then.
And they don't go late.
No.
So, I could see if we're worried about going so long.
Yeah. I just ask.
Yeah.
Doesn't really matter to us.
I'm always surprised how much that half hour makes, I can't get dinner ever, it seems.
Yeah. Yeah.
How many financial forums are we having?
Four, I think.
Three.
Yeah, let's go with 7:30.
I thought it was four.
I think tentatively those were 7 o'clock, but I wanted to ask you, I don't know if it's set in the calendar necessarily. Yeah, didn't say. The selectmen's meetings will be 7 o'clock, just so you know, in December.
Will be seven in December.
And school committee will also be 7 o'clock in January.
Yeah, it's too much.
Peter will just have to stop me asking questions, and we'll have been out of here by 8:30.
I'll tell you.
Yes, you're definitely right about people coming in from Boston, sometimes I wonder if we're gonna need to have like a, if we have a quorum on the train, and we have to post a notice, you know, it gets tricky, no, never quite that many, but.
Especially hard in the winter. I would ask you, and I'm sure you figure this out, please ask all your questions that you can think of in December, as many as you want, in the selectmen's meetings, if you have any advance, obviously those are always welcome too, but just to help the January, February period go by, as much as we can front load is good, doesn't mean there's no opportunity later, but that would be good.
Any further?
Number 20.
Motion to adjourn?
I can certainly, we definitely need that, and nothing else anybody wants to bring up, I have a motion to adjourn, I have a second.
Second.
All in favor? And opposed?